I'm going to mix things up this time around by starting the video with a fun fact. Did you know that pouring dozens of hours into a 40-minute video about your favorite show is exhausting? I sure didn't, and now I'm in a bit of a tight spot because I'm too tired to make a new video. But I think I'll be alright. I've got a failsafe for situations like these. Now if you'll excuse me for indulging myself this time around, let's change the channel to something comforting. When I first finished Tomoko Market a handful of months back and my brother asked me why I liked it, I told him it was very relaxing, like a warm bath after a long day of work. You're free to bask in my genius because after giving it a proper second look, I don't think I could have picked a better analogy to go with. Tomoko is the most welcoming, optimistic, and feel-good show I've ever seen. That's what I remembered it for. And while I certainly recaptured those feelings on my second trip to the Usagiyama shopping district, I was also met with so many more enticing elements worthy of praise than I ever thought existed in this short slice of life before. Tomoko Market is about a girl named Tomoko Kitashirakawa, never saying that again, whose family runs a mochi store near the shopping district. She's got a next door neighbor who's madly in love with her named Mochizo Oji. She's got some cool friends who she hangs out with in the Baton Club, and one day a talking bird named Dara finds his way to her while looking for a potential candidate to be his prince's bride. That's all you really need to know. This show doesn't bet any of its chips on the plot, which makes sense when you consider who was behind it. Naoko Yamada is an extremely interesting figure in the industry for me. She's known for portraying life in a stupidly effective way through grounded stories told by the emotions of its characters more than anything else. The plot doesn't really matter. It's essentially set dressing for 30 minutes of laid-back entertainment with a good takeaway at the end. Nobody's turning on an episode of Tomoko Market because they're on the edge of their seat to find out whether or not Dara's diet is going well. It's a little more complicated than that. The journey to becoming a fan of this show begins by stepping outside of whatever box you've crafted for storytelling and just letting yourself get lost in its charming simplicity. Sound familiar? Tomoko makes it extremely easy to do this, as every aspect of it is tailor-made for the sole purpose of making the audience feel good. Take the shopping district itself, for example. It's a welcoming place run by a large, colorful cast of characters, all living modest lives and enjoying each other's company every single day. Whenever Tomoko cheerfully skips down these vibrant streets, she's greeted with nothing but friendly faces. The show makes it a point to throw a multitude of characters unfamiliar with Usagiyama right into the middle of its loving embrace, much to their surprise. Dara shows up and he's immediately accepted by the community, despite the fact that he's a talking bird who should probably be dissected for scientific purposes. Then comes Tomoko's teacher, a girl from Dara's island named Choi Mochimazui, the prince himself. Everyone is showered with smiles and free handouts regardless of who they are. The most memorable instance of this fish out of water scenario comes from Shiori Asagiri. She's extremely shy, the kind of person who just blends into the background. And I mean that literally, because she's always been in the background watching Tomoko hang out with her friends in the Baton Club since she plays badminton in the same gym. She's initially very cold to Tomoko because she doesn't want her poor communication skills to ruin anything with her, but thanks to Dara, she's brought through the shopping district all the way to Tomoko's house, receiving exactly the kind of treatment you'd expect. By some miracle of nature, she ends up helping make dinner, and the next day, she can finally bring herself to say that she had a lot of fun hanging out with everyone, and that she wants to be friends. Now, some of you already know that I'm not a fan of Moe in the slightest, and if you didn't, you do now. But man, this is such an intoxicating explosion of sunshine and rainbows that I can't possibly justify being too good for this show. It's so pleasant. Too pleasant. Stuff like this would never fly in the real world. Hey man, I just wanted to let you know that you're the coolest pal a guy could ask for, and you make me smile every day, and you know, I just feel all warm and tingly when I'm around you.
I don't understand why you're not in my room, on my bed, naked.
Hold
posing.
On.
I don't
Wait.
Understand.
No, hold on. That's
I don't
not
understand.
Where this is going.
I have the lubricant.
Wait, no.
Even hide the condoms.
Cut the thing. The scenario I just described is a perfect example of the comforting atmosphere Tomoko Market creates for the viewer. And the best part is, Kiyoani's commitment to crafting this environment encompasses every single element of the show, not just its location. The aesthetics are an easy example of this. Colors are vibrant and animations are cutesy. Everyone peeks around corners like it's Scooby fucking Doo. One thing in particular that stuck out to me this time around was the night skies. I couldn't tell you why, they just look nice to me, which I find to be very fitting, because a good night sky is the universally accepted most relaxing thing to look at on the planet. When it comes to the characters, all of them play a role in bringing the shopping district to life. There are no weak links. Tomoko herself is excessively cheerful, albeit a little too dense for her own good. You've got a scene where Anko hides behind her for a full minute while a boy she clearly likes walks by, and Tomoko can't figure out what the issue is. Long after the moment has passed, she half-heartedly comes to the conclusion that they're mortal enemies. She's as likable as she is stupid. Mochizo is a chill dude who belongs to the film club at school. He proves to be exceptional at both playing the straight man and chasing after Tomoko's affection, a pursuit that's frequently halted by her best friend, Midori Tokiwa. This is because she has a thing for Tomoko herself, and despite basically being this dude's antagonist, she's never unlikable thanks to her caring and hardworking personality. Kana Makino is the best thing about this show, no questions asked. If you've seen it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Dera brings a lot to the cast by being refreshingly arrogant, and he's great at tying scenes together due to the fact that he can hang out anywhere he wants without consequence. Choi is responsible for a lot of this show's staying power in its latter half, thanks to her single-handedly moving the prince plot forward. Dera sure as hell wasn't going to do it, much to her chagrin, making her one of the few characters willing to constantly butt heads with him over his behavior. The other one that comes to mind is Anko, who, despite being Tomoko's sister, couldn't be more different from her. She's more practical and mature, constantly keeping the bubbly nature of the rest of the cast in check alongside her father. Tomoko's father is a total buzzkill, and that's what I like about him. He's as traditional with his business as it gets, and almost everything his kids request of him is met with a firm hell no. Okay, whatever you say, man. The guy has a heart of gold, though. Something shown primarily through the love song he wrote for his now-deceased wife back in high school. It falls just short of dethroning Kana as the best thing about this show. Just short. Speaking of music, the soundtrack is exceptional at sending pleasing feelings to the viewer as expected, but the really good stuff comes from when the music is used for more than just this. The music shop in Usagiyama often plays diegetic music for comedic effect. My favorite instance being the one where Dera is told he needs to go on a diet, and that famous organ piece I can't pronounce plays over his mortified expression. This show can be pretty funny when it wants to be, but up until now I've just been describing everything that makes Tomoko Market laid back and fun to watch. There's still a huge part of this show that I tossed to the side in the beginning of this video that needs addressing. I said the plot of this show doesn't matter, and that's only half true. I couldn't care less about the actual events that take place in the shopping district. What I do care about is how these events tie together to create interesting themes, character growth, and a genuine message. The first big theme comes from the show's most repeated quote.
Everybody loves some.
A phrase so unapologetically corny that I feel like my style of writing is being directly threatened. There are countless examples of this, whether between friends, family, or potential partners, but all roads tend to lead back to Tomoko. After all, Tomoko loves everybody, and everybody loves her back. It's pretty inspiring watching this beacon of optimism go about her day, taking in just as much goodwill as she dishes out. To me, she stands tall as an ideal figure, not meant to show you you how you should be, but to give you a pretty good model to work off of. But for those looking for a more realistic side of this coin, Midori is your character. In my eyes, she has the most solid character arc in the show, and it's all thanks to the way it depicts her feelings for Tomoko. As strange as this sounds, it's handled in a way that's both subtle and completely obvious. Her feelings are never directly referred to once, but any casual observer can put two and two together based on her actions and body language. There are no audience-only third-person superpowers here. You have to figure out her thought process of discovering, hiding, defending, and eventually giving up on her affection for Tomoko the same way you would a real person. This touch of realism is so indicative of the way Naoko Yamada tells her stories that I'm not the least bit surprised that this is my favorite arc. I'm particularly fond of its conclusion, but if I'm going to get to that, I need to wrap up my thoughts on the show and move on to its sequel film. The only thing I have left to mention is a faint glimmer of a theme that's sure to give anyone who experienced Clannad PTSD. Change. Tomoko Market's plot ends with Tomoko being mistaken for the prince's bride, a mistake that ultimately has no consequences as she would have declined either way, but it got everybody thinking. Life in the shopping district is pretty great, however everyone here is getting older. People have ambitions that need to be met, life goals that need to be pursued, so it's only a matter of time until an important figure takes a step forward into the future, leaving the shopping district behind. The only question is, who's going to be the first person to break that window? Tomoko Love Story seeks to tie up the show's biggest loose ends while also working as a standalone story. Just as the title implies, this movie is about Mochizo finally coming clean to Tomoko about his feelings for her, because he'll be leaving for Tokyo to go to film school as soon as he graduates high school. Throughout the entirety of the show, Tomoko just kind of lived in Tomoko Land without ever dealing with a serious problem. Most of the conflicts happen to the people around her, and when she eventually is wrapped up in something big, it turns out to just be a false alarm. But here she is now, being hand-delivered to bombshells by Mochizo. I'm leaving forever, and by the way, I've liked you ever since we were kids. And as expected, something breaks in her brain, which has known nothing but the shopping district and Mochi for its entire existence. Holy f***ing sh**. This is what real life conflicts are like. The rest of the movie is an exploration into both Tomoko and Mochizo's feelings in an effort to portray adolescent love in a realistic way. I'm of the opinion that Kyoto Animation makes phenomenal films, and the biggest reason for this is because I think they're very good at settling on a clear vision for the final product and following through. When a movie knows what it is, it gives its creators the power to add or subtract as many elements as they want to complement the film's direction. The pacing is slow and methodical, savoring every little moment of indirect characterization. The color palette is more mature, with darker colors and more overt instances of shading than Market ever had. There are a significant number of first-person shots with artificial camera movements in order to visually show off the grounded nature of the movie. And while this last one doesn't directly have anything to do with complementing the goals of the film, I think the writing has taken a significant step up from the show thanks to clever character moments and a lot of genuine wit. Midori's arc comes to a close with this film, as she comes to terms with what Tomoko truly wants and moves on. She watches Tomoko slowly process all of her emotions throughout the movie, with concern and subtle hints of heartache. But when Tomoko finally makes up her mind, she decides that she needs to support her decision, even if it goes against her wishes. In fact, she's the entire reason these two end up together at the end of the film, thanks to a white lie. The character growth she goes through is emblematic of what this film is trying to say about change. It's not about what happens to you, it's about how you handle it. Would you sit at home sulking about how everything sucks because it's all constantly changing, or would you have the courage to be honest with yourself and confront it head on, whether you're prepared to or not? And, wow. I know I joked about the similarities to Clannad, but now I think I'm treading the line between commonality and plagiarism. To be clear, Tomoko delivers this message in a very unique way. It's simple, grounded, and as humble as they come.
後悔の苦さは何かをした証。
Gone are the fantastical oddities from the show, such as Dara and Choi, with her unrealistically potent fortune-telling. What you see is what you get, and all you're going to see are a few kids discovering themselves in the face of rapid change. When it comes to anime, people tend to throw a lot of praise at wild stories that break all kinds of conventions. I'm willing to stand with that crowd any day, but I think it's just as important to show appreciation for those who can paint over the utterly mundane in such a vibrant and expressive way. The Tomoko series is simple. So simple that it can be described in just one sentence. Market is a relaxing romp through everything that makes the human spirit wonderful, and Love Story is a down-to-earth tale that focuses on growth through change. But just because dismissing it like this is such an easy thing to do doesn't mean it's the right thing to do. I have to be honest, I was a victim of this mindset for a while. Half of the things I mentioned in this video didn't even come close to crossing my mind my first time watching through. But nowadays, things are different. I still wouldn't put it up there with my all-time favorites, but I've grown to appreciate everything this show has to offer, expressed with such purity that it could only have come from a studio that's run like a family instead of a money factory, no matter the time or the day. I'll always be willing to take another short but sweet journey through the happiest corner of the world, because there will always be room in my life for a piece of media that's as enjoyable as it is truly heartwarming.